Fundamentals of software testing, testing tools and documentation. Testing tools. We have now used some of them. There are still several types of tools that exist that we haven't used, and it depends in which company or organization you are working, what kind of a set of tools you will have, but there are plenty of those tools. Many of them are pretty much the same that are used in the actual development. When you are doing unit testing, you can use NetBeans. If you are doing coding, you can use NetBeans. So the same tool is used in both tasks. And then there are tools that are developed for testing purposes only. So for example, if you are programming with C, you have probably met the Walgreen tool that is used to find memory leaks. So if the program is run with Walgreen, it says that okay, this program has leaked this and this much memory. So then you can just debug and find those memory leaks. Of course, you could use some other programming language that has an automatic memory control, such as Java or Python, then you would not need to worry about those issues. Now we have used unit testing. We have used JUnit, and it's developed for testing purposes. And the most important tools for testers are these integrated development environments and communication tools. Of course, it's depending if you are doing only, let's say, user interface testing or acceptance testing, then the IDE is not the tool you are using. And it is useless to find errors if one cannot report. So testing is a lot of writing documentation, reporting it. Tools that have been developed for testing. We have our testing automation tools. We have bug databases, mock and stub generators, analyzing tools, debuggers, document templates, document tools, supporting tools for testing environments. So there are plenty of tools to choose from. Let's talk about a bit more of these integrated development environments. And they are very powerful today, and they can integrate to source control services like GitHub or any other such system. They provide debugging tools, and they generate a lot of code. NetBeans can generate you getters and setters, destructors, constructors, etc. And they generate also test case templates, so you don't need to write them manually. They are somewhat generated automatically. And with the IDE, one can write code, generate code, get mistake, a typo notification, and correction success. Those all are given by NetBeans, but there are other IDEs also that give those features, such as Eclipse or IntelliJ. Also, you could use some kind of more of an editor, such as Visual Studio Code or Atom or Sublime. They are also good, but they don't have all the things listed here, just in the out of the box. And all these mentioned things, they are there to remove some mistake possibilities. So if you have a possible to make a typo, then it's good that there is a system that checks your what you are writing and says that this is probably typo. Would you like to fix it? And as it was told in the Matrix, never send a human to do a machine's job. So computers are good in some jobs, let them do that job. And the rest is still our jobs as humans to do. YouTube is full of great tutorials on how to unleash the power of IDE. For example, you could check NetBeans and debugging with breakpoints. You get a nice 5-minute video to describe how to do it. Worth of watching if you are not familiar with those tools. We have been using this JUnit, which is part of this XUnit family, which is a family of unit test frameworks, and originally it was developed for Smalltalk, which is a object-oriented programming language that was mainly used in the, let's say, 80s and 90s, probably still, but not that much. So there was SUnit. It was developed by Kent Beck, who is also very famous in the agile development world. Nowadays, basically every major language has its own implementation, or plenty of those. For example, for Java or C or C++, there are dozens of implementations of XUnit. So, for example, CUnit for C, CppUnit for C++, DUnit for D, HUnit for Haskell, JUnit for Java, PHPUnit for PHP, and PyUnit for Python, SUnit for Smalltalk. So these are just to mention a few. Testing is also a lot of communication and documentation. Communication is one of the most important things in all projects, not just software engineering ones, and not just testing tasks. It's always, if the communication fails, then everything will fail. You probably have noticed it, that if you are doing a group work and the group doesn't communicate at all, then the group work will not be as good as if the group would be communicating well. So if we are checking this kind of a small project, that there is a customer and then there is a vendor, and in this project there is, from vendor side, there is only project manager, one developer and one tester, then there is communication between project manager and tester, project manager and developer, tester and developer, and customer and project manager. Those are at least communicating. Probably in this kind of a small project, customer is also directly communicating with developer, maybe even with tester, it depends. And the bigger the project becomes, then there will be much more of those lines connecting different persons. So there will be a lot of communication, and it's crucial to have that communication done well. And guess what? Email is not the correct tool. So in small project, you could use email. And if there is no other tool, then email is better than nothing. But there are much better tools also. Probably you could use some kind of a bug reporting tool called Ticket System, for example Jira. That could be suitable, and then some direct communication. For example, Slack or Microsoft Teams might do it, even IRC or WhatsApp might be okay. It depends on the project. And if communication fails, the project will fail. So how to report bug? So there are tools. In this picture here on the right, it's from Jira. I will demonstrate it later. There are tools like Bugzilla or Atlas and Jira. They are very popular, widely used ones. Bugzilla is open source, and Atlas and Jira, you can use it for free if you have a small team. Was it up to 10 or up to 20 people? It's for free, and then if it's bigger, then you need to pay. With these tools, one can report bugs found in software. That is very important, especially if you are working with open source software, that anyone could report bugs. So do you want to get hundreds of emails per day, or do you want to have a central system that would note that if someone is reporting bug that has also already been reported? That's one thing that you find very useful, so you won't get the same bug reported over and over again. And this kind of a ticket system bug reporting tool, it's the place where tester and customer tester slash customer to have a discussion between developers and when you are communicating is, let's say, in Jira, all the communication is documented, all the comments, all the developer notes, all of these, they are documented, and all the bugs are assigned to someone, and bugs have, of course, severity or priority levels. Time tracking is possible, so how much you spent fixing database bug, or how much you spent time fixing an user interface bug, and then the project manager can see that, okay, it takes a lot more time to fix those user interface bugs. Maybe we should get a new developer for that job, etc. These kind of things can be found, and bugs can be linked to epics or other bugs. Epics are very big user stories, so big tasks that they cannot be completed in one sprint. And yeah, bugs can have sub-bugs. About more about the documentation. Agile Manifesto itself has an opinion on this topic, and it was written that working software is much more important than a comprehensive documentation. But we still need documentation. We cannot live without it. So if we are not documenting at all, then we are failing. And a lot of documentation is within the code itself. There are comments, there are good names for variables and class methods, etc. When these have been written well, then the lowest point of documentation is handled okay. And then there is also a problem if you are documenting very heavily everything. You can end up in a situation where documents have not been updated. There are so many documents that no one is keeping them updated because there are just too much of them. And then those documents might have wrong information, which is very bad. Wrong documentation, wrong commenting, it's worse than no documentation, no commenting. And you have to remember that bug reporting is documenting. So testing produces a lot of documentation, and this documentation is useful. So you need to think clearly how heavy documentation you are building manually, or are you trusting that you are having automatically produced documentation, which is the test case. Some of the test case systems, they report some automatically some parts, like the formal part. If you are documenting a test case, you have probably some formal parts, which is sprint ID this and that, and there is a test ID this, and there is a issue XYZ. And then there are informal information, like the comment, the button seems to have an incorrect sizing on Firefox Mobile. That is much more informal. And what would happen if we would live without documentation? So software development and testing could not be carried out in large scale without documentation. That's for sure. So how would one developer give information to the next one if they could not give some kind of a documentation that I have done this, and it has been done like this because of this, and the next developer could then carry it on. And how would tester know whether a task has been tested or not? That's another thing. So you really need documentation. And of course, there are customers that might want to get a very specific documentation. For example, they have been building a system with one vendor, and then they decide that this vendor is not good, and they change the organization building the system for them, and then they need to get the, for example, the configuration documentation of server and my environment, so that the next vendor could build a similar or exactly the same kind of a server environment where the system is then run. So there's a dilemma. How to document enough relevant things, but nothing irrelevant? And there is definitely correct answer. It really depends on case. But if you're not documenting anything, then you are not doing things right. So how much one should spend time on documentation? Well, it's not zero, but it's not 100% either. So you really need to think when you're starting a project and what kind of a project we are now doing and how much we are documenting. Level of documentation. So it depends heavily on what one is testing. If you are testing just a WordPress site for cat's funeral, then there is really not much testing. So basically, even quite ad hoc testing is suitable. Why is it suitable? Basically, this site has probably just something like a few sentences of text in the internet, maybe the image of the cat itself, and then there might be some kind of a link for registration for the funeral. And the reason why ad hoc testing is suitable in this case is that the platform WordPress or the LAMP environment under it has been well tested by the WordPress community. So there has been a lot of testing already. So the quite ad hoc testing that is required is just that there is a right cat in the image. So it's not just image bank cat, but it's the right Misse or David, whoever it is. Then if you are testing a nuclear power plant or space rocket, it requires everything to be documented formally, tested and accepted. So let's say you would be building a nuclear power plant in the somewhere in the western coast of Finland. Would it take 5 years or 15 years to build it? It doesn't matter, you still need to document everything, and all the documentation needs to be, even all the documentation, the system itself needs to be tested, but also the documentation needs to be tested and accepted. And it's probably accepted by several guys who are writing the documentation. First they accept that it's okay, then the customer accepted the documentation and the software, and then there are some authorities, State of Finland, who will somehow want to test it. Säteilyturvakeskus wants to read all the documentation. So just in this month, there was once again a rocket startup, Astra. They launched a rocket in Alaska, very north, and it failed. And they said that the next launch will have a software fix. So there was an error in the software. It seems that it was not tested well enough, but was the documentation written well? The story doesn't tell. Hopefully there is a clear documentation and clear testing, and you could go to see that, okay, this has not been tested, or it has been tested and the test has failed and we are still launching the rocket, or the test has passed, so why the test has passed when there is still a problem. This is when everything is documented, then you can really improve your software work. So testing without documenting it is not testing. And when we are documenting a test, what we are doing? So we are doing a document. It can be some kind of a Word template, or it could be in some kind of a in some cloud service like Bugzilla or Jira. But there are still several must-have fields. So, for example, first of all, ID field. Then you are able to refer to test. So it must have a unique ID. Without it, there would be just random text mass. Then there are some kind of identification that who has been done the testing. So you could ask for more information if that's necessary. And then there is a description what have been done. So what was done? What was the input? And steps that were carried out, and output, what was the result? And then there is probably some kind of a description why the output was not what was expected, or then it was if the test was passed. And then there are some fields that probably exist, so there would be some kind of a summary. Maybe reference to existing requirements, story or epic. So there is a user story that the system needs to have a button that enables printing a report, and then the test case is a reference to that that story, and then it tested that the printing works. And then there is probably priority or severity levels, and when, meaning date, or with what version of the software the testing has been carried out. So if we are testing a three year old version of the software and the test fails, that is kind of useless for the developers, because it has been developed 3 years further and that has already been fixed. So that's why we are reporting what version, probably the newest version, what we are testing here. And then there might be some attachments, probably a screenshot. Okay, this thing website doesn't render well in Firefox Mobile or Safari or some kind of that kind of a thing, and you can take a screenshot with your mobile phone or your desktop computer. Okay, let's have a short demonstrate on. So this is Atlassian Jira, and I have a test project here. I have already reported two bugs here, but let's create a new bug report. So this is my project. There are no other projects. So what we are reporting now, we are reporting bug. We could also use this as a reporting some kind of a improvement suggestion or new tasks to be carried out, or even new feature, or even big new epic, that completely new feature that is huge. So we would like to add some big thing. But now we are reporting a bug. So so let's see that there is a bug that Yeah, that's the summary part, and then we would write some kind of a descriptions like this. So how you would reproduce the bug. So you log in the system with your username, password, you open browser's inspector, change the cookie value, user ID to any other number, and if that ID exists, then you are logged in as another user, and that is very dangerous. Please fix this. So who is reporting it? That's me who is reporting it. And the priority, I would say that this kind of a bug is the highest priority, and then we could say that there is a security new label. And then there are parts like how estimate how much work this is done. Of course, when I'm reporting it as a just non-developer, I don't need to fill anything here. Then environment, okay, I used Firefox 72 or something. I have no idea how big number Firefox has nowadays. And I could use I could attach some kind of a screenshot here, for example, and if there is a due date which I don't have, are there any issues that is blocking this? No. Assigned automatic epic link. I don't have any epics here, so let's create a new bug. So now a new bug is here. So then the developer can go and okay, this kind of a bug is there. Oh, whoa, I need to fix this immediately, and then he can take it in progress and do some things that is his task. And then there can be communication here in the bug. Developer can say that this should be now fixed. Can you test it? Then the guy comes back and tests it. Okay, now I cannot use any the other users' data. Get that. So it's very well working then. Okay, so this is just Jira. Much used in the industry. So if you are working with a software company, you might end up working with Jira. And then there are other tools also, but they are quite similar. Similar, they are just different names. So let's go back to conclusion. So there are plenty of tools to be used in testing. Every organization has its own tool set, so when you are working with a company, you will find what kind of tools they are using. So there are programming tools that are also used in testing, so for example NetBeans. And then there are actual testing tools which are developed 100% for testing, like Valgrind, and documentation tools. Jira is, for example, used in documentation and also in communication. But then again, there are other tools for communication, such as Slack or Microsoft Teams or WhatsApp or Earcall, whatever. And testing creates documentation, which is good. And every test case needs to be documented automatically or manually. So if you're using automatic unit testing, then some kind of a documentation comes automatically, or at least it should be configured so that there would be automatic documentation that these tests are run and they are passed or failed. And customer or vendor needs to communicate while testing, but also during the whole project, and otherwise the project will fail.